truth about
niema
a Christian contending for the faith.
Lorada mani ma la Christai chumpi niema.
Now this is also to concretize on some of the things I've already done.
E libeti dome moko chalene kumje mo ma dati mo gyo.
To do with man-centered gospel.
Malupe ki jiri ma jenge kum tamyo ki padan.
Versus Christ-centered gospel.
Kilo jiri ma jenge kum Christo ke kan.
And also what I have done.
Gin madong bati mo.
To do with the lives of the false ministers.
Gopa pa jomo ko magiluonge ne gin lutuji.
The Church of Christ.
E kanicha pa Christo.
And where we also built onto another thing to do with the whole truth that is found in two. The scripture and how you and I
are
supposed to uphold the word of God as the body of truth that is more sure than any physical experience. So let us begin with Jude. Chapter 1.
Judah chua na chie.
It has only one chapter.
Judah tiki chua na chie, okay?
But it has a lot in it.
Ento tiki je mungu madunga dada ye.
That guides us.
Ah, mano tierwa.
Onto how.
Ikila chalo.
We are to be aware of the false ministers.
Mierwa belkum na wangwa ture kum. Ah, jo mungu magi tiero jir mungu.
What is very interesting today.
Mano time yom chunyo me wut tuwa jir.
That Jude appears to be a short book.
Ene ni Judah nana chalo vok marong chie.
But it is too much packed up with the wonderful truth that can guide believers in the time where we are. So my simple work I'm going to do is to go through the entire chapter. If I don't finish today, I'll finish another time. However, I just want you to follow with
us
in your Bibles. It begins by saying, Jude, the servant of Jesus Christ.
Jude, the teach by Jesus Christ.
What is very amazing, this gentleman, what we know, is one of the two half brothers of Jesus Christ. This one together with James. But you know, when Jesus was carrying out his ministry, many of his brothers also never believed upon him until the time of the resurrection. That is why he had to reveal himself to all of them in different phases. So the Bible says that many of his brothers never believed
upon him.
When you consider the Gospel of John, chapter 7, it gives us all that evidence. But now when they realized that indeed the man had risen and he was not an individual trying to proclaim what was not of him, we see when Jude is writing, he says a servant. He didn't say Jude, a brother of Jesus. But he came to a place of knowing his rightful position, where he was so very much convinced
that
the best place for me in Christ is to be a servant. And then the other thing he adds in to say is at least to show us that he had a brother. Among they that were moving together with Christ, by saying, and the brother of James. Now this is the James we know that Herod actually had to behead, because many people were calling him God, and then he wanted at least to find a way of getting many of them motivated by his actions of persecuting the believers. And then the Bible also adds in to say, to them that are sanctified, when he writes to the believers. And then he says believers are sanctified, meaning we are already made saints. We are not about to be saints, but we are already made saints in
Christ.
And it is because of our being in Christ that we have shared the sainthood of Christ. The same is true in 1 Corinthians 1:13. The Bible says because of God we are in Christ, who has become unto us wisdom, sanctification, redemption and what we call righteousness. So whoever is in Christ, you are already made a saint. We are not waiting for another individual to proclaim us as saints, but because of our being in Christ, meaning that the lesser being in the greater. Every time we talk about us being in Christ, we are the lesser being in the greater. However, most people like it so much to say that Christ is in me. That is very true. But what is very much sounding is you knowing that you are located in Him. That's why Acts 17:28 says that in Him we live, move, and have our being. So it is because of our being in Christ that we can have a very good definition of who we are. The moment we disassociate from our position in Christ, we have no proper definition. So the right way to say is us being in Christ. That means that everything that defines who He is is what defines us. Sanctification. And then the Bible adds in to say, sanctified by God. It's not an activity that is done of man. Our sanctification is an origin of God. That is why God is not ashamed of us. More to that, Hebrews 2:11 says, Him that sanctifies and they that are sanctified are both one. So the sanctification we have is sourcing from Christ. So it has nothing like any question mark on it. Then the Bible also adds in to say that the Father and preserved in Christ. Our preservation is in Christ Jesus. The moment you are outside Christ, you cannot be preserved. That's why Jesus says in John chapter 10, and the verses 28, He says, they that belong unto me, I give unto them eternal life, and no any man can snatch them out of my hands. Because the Father who has given them to me is greater than they all. So we are preserved in Christ. And the Bible says also in Colossians 3 and the verses 3-4 that Christ is our real life. The day He will appear, we shall appear together with Him in glory, and we concretize that one also in Colossians 2:10, which says we are complete in Christ. There is nothing physical that completes a believer. However, our position that we have in Christ has made us to be preserved in Him. That is why 1 John 4:4 says, greater is He in us than he that is in the world. And more to that, what the apostle says in Romans 8, the verses 34-35, what is it that will ever separate us from the love of God that we have in Christ? So because we are preserved in Christ, there is nothing that can ever separate us from the love of God that we have in Christ. Therefore, it also adds in to say, not only are we preserved in Christ, but we are also called. This is also substantiated by Romans 8:30, which tells us, to us that are already predestined by God, He has justified us. And we that he has justified, he has called. And to us that are called, he has also glorified us. That is all a reality because of our being in Christ. And then verses 2 of Jude 1, it says, mercy unto you. Why does he talk of mercy? Because what we never deserved is what God has given unto us. You and I were undeserving. There was nothing good about us. When we hear of God loving the world, not because we had something special, but he chose out of his agape love to lavish his love upon us. So it is his love that has made us to receive the mercy. So Jude says, mercy to you and peace. Why does he also talk about peace? Because Bible says in Romans 5, therefore being justified by faith, we have peace with God through Christ Jesus. God is not our enemy. Why? Because 2 Corinthians 5 and the verse is 19, it says God was in Christ reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their sins unto them, but he has given unto us a ministry of reconciliation. So God is not our enemy, however, it's our friend. That is why Hebrews 4 verses 16 says, you can now approach the throne of grace on the throne of judgment, because the judgment is already passed the blood of Christ. That is why John chapter 19 verse 36, it is all finished, so we can fellowship with God at any time, because the animosity between us and God has been taken away in the blood of Christ. Then more to that, it says love. What is also very interesting is 1 John 4:8. We are born of God. The God is what? The God who is love. Therefore, when he says mercy, peace, and love, because we are not estranged from love, we are born of love. The best to say to the believers is love to you. Therefore, also adds in to say, be multiplied. So the more we continue to fellowship in his word, the more we realize how much that mercy has been given unto us, how much of that shalom peace has been extended to us, how much of God's love has been given unto us that were undeserving. Look at verse 3, Jude. It says, beloved, when I gave all diligence, beloved, when I gave all diligence to write unto you, mark this one very well, it wasn't just that this person didn't have enough time to ponder about what he was going to discuss, but he says, I gave all due diligence. So whatever he's going to write to us, or whatever he has written unto us, the Bible says he gave it an outstanding attention, and he gave it also an outstanding diligence. He was so sure of what he was going to write to us. Check on that. There are several people who write because they are suffering from what to do. So I think let me just write a short thing here. We call it free writing. Just write whatever that is coming. But this man, the Bible says, I gave all diligence to write to you. Meaning you were precious unto the person writing. When he pondered on how much precious you are to the Lord, he had to give diligence. He had to say to his thoughts on it. You see, you can do something not having the full attention of you. But this man says, as I begin to write, I gave all diligence. I had to be sure. I had to ponder on each and every word, on each and every thought. But as I pen it down, I am very sure I have nothing like any distraction. However, I am on it. I want it to be understood. That's the same thing you should do. Whenever you're doing something for another person, give due diligence and do give it your best. If anything has your name on it, you have to defend it with diligence, not just doing something for the sake of doing. That's why when Jesus came, he says, for this cause I was born. He had a cause that he had to finish. And when we remember Paul, he said, none of these things move me. However, I want to finish my course in life to proclaim of the gospel of grace unto all people. So, though he had several challenges that came his way, he said, none of that thing was to move him, because he had also to be very diligent to finishing what Christ had commissioned him. And then he adds into saying, I write to you of the common salvation. Why does the Bible call it common salvation? Because what we have received in the name of what we call salvation, it's the same thing that Jews have received. That's why we call it common salvation. The same way a Gentile gets into the kingdom, that's the same way the Jews get into the kingdom. Remember Romans 1:17. Just shall live by faith. Now, before he comes to that, 16, he says that he was not ashamed of the gospel, because it was the power of God unto all men salvation. He says to the Jews first, and also to the Greeks. The Greeks being a representative of all of us as Gentiles. So our salvation is common in the sense that we don't have two different saviors. We have one soul savior. What pertains to a Jew pertains to a Gentile. So it's a common salvation. Now let us back it up. Titus 1:4. Because like we have already said, the Bible should explain the Bible, not just running through the verse. You are just running through the verse. You end up missing a lot of things. Now, the Bible says something here in the book of Titus, chapter 1, and the verse is 4. It says to Titus, my own son, after the common faith. So the common faith could mean the same thing to do with the common salvation. Because there is no salvation minus faith in the person of Christ. So he says to Titus, my own son, after the common faith. What was the uniting factor between Titus and Paul? It was the common faith. Had Titus not believed, there wasn't anything that would unite the two. Because they are born from different families. But what makes them to be common? The that makes them to be one. It's the faith. That's why all believers in Christ, we are all one. We are brothers and sisters born from different families. But in Christ we are one. That is why 1 Corinthians 6:17 says, any man be joined to the Lord, they are one single spirit. We are one in Christ Jesus, because we are partakers of the Spirit of Christ. We are not like the Corinthians who are trying to partition Christ. Some say we belong to Paul, some say we belong to Apollos, and others say we belong to Peter. And Paul had to say to them, is Christ divided? Christ is not divided. Therefore, believers ought not to be divided. Wherever you are born, independent of your geographical location, we are one. Then the Bible adds in to say, the common salvation, it was needful. Why was it needful? For me to write unto you. Now be very careful with these letters that are actually so very close to the book of Revelation. They are not actually aligned chronologically because someone was missing something to do. They are put in that kind of order because of a message that they wanted to communicate. That is why it is not a coincidence that before you go to much of what we call the journal episodes, that is basically from the book of Hebrews to the book of Jude, you first actually have the books of Paul come in to show you the indicatives and the imperatives, who you are and how you're supposed to live. So by the time you come to brother James, brother Peter, brother John, there is a scholar that had to furnish you very well, because these other guys are not very good at explaining so much. They just drop it there and say, deal with it. Whoever does not love his friend, you don't love the Lord. Then you ask yourself a question: am I a believer? It have gotten a foundation. How can you say that you love God yet you cannot love your neighbor? They keep quiet. You have to deal with it. But you need to have understood what Paul says. An understanding that because of our being in Christ, that oneness has to be there. You need to know that if any man be in Christ, it's a new creation. So you love them all because you've all become new creations. So that's one of the main reasons as to why the one who came afterwards appears to be having the first books. And they that walked with Christ, they have their books last. One of the outstanding things was not a fisherman. The man was a scholar. He says, you know what? I studied. I'm a Pharisee. Becoming a Pharisee, you don't just wake up and declare that I'm a Pharisee. No, you need to have been a scholar. You need to have studied. He would not have told Timothy that study to show yourself approved, when for him it was just a job low believer. No. The man was a student, and on several occasions he told Timothy, whenever you come to me, come with my books. Don't forget them. You don't find Peter saying, come with my books. Peter doesn't have that time. Peter tells you, at the holy mountain, we heard the voice. Doesn't have that thing of reading for what? But when it comes to Paul, you need to be a student. So, but that doesn't mean that it was because of the scholarly design of Paul that made him actually to be used of the Lord. None of us is qualified working for the Lord. However, the mercy of the Lord has made all of us to be accepted. So don't say, now, since I don't know anything to do with the books, I'm giving up for serving the Lord. You serve the Lord.
Well,
then let me tell you, the scriptures will make you more wiser than what the training will make you. I have seen doctors and lawyers who are walking unwisely, but they have all the doctrine. When you come into the scripture, you become a different person. Someone used to know you as a fool. They begin to hear and say, if this is not God, better if I don't know. Now that means that they are attesting to the fact this had to be an intervention of God. Minus the intervention of God, you wouldn't have been a person. So scripture will make you wise. That's the same thing Paul told Timothy. Second Timothy. That don't forget the reading of the scriptures. You know, from your very childhood, you've been made wise through the reading of the scriptures. The same is true, David said, I have become more wiser than my teachers because I keep your word. And I am not going to live in sin because I have hid your word in my heart. That's very powerful. Then he adds in to say, it was needful for me to write to you and to exalt you. What is exaltation all about? This is actually only to the church. That is why Hebrews 10:25 says, don't give up the manner of meeting together. There you're being exalted. You're being exalted. You're being edified and being built in the common faith. But the moment we don't meet together, we can't be built in the common faith. That is why he says, exhort you that you should honestly contend for the faith. Now this word does not appear anywhere in the New Testament other than what we have here, where it talks about honestly contending. What are we supposed to contend for? What is the meaning of contending? There's a reason as to why he used this word here. Very struggling. This is one thing that we are going to be through. We have to persevere. Amid us contending for the faith, there is mushrooming of so many wrong teachings around. And even when we are trying to do something, it appears as if we are doing nothing. That's why one has to contend honestly. One has to be very much devoted. Because if you are non-devoted, you might actually think God is not on your side. Because Paul tells us in 2 Timothy 3, verse 13, that people who are actually doing untrue things, they are going to continue to grow worse. But the moment you forget to know that, at times it can actually appear to be very discouraging. And you say, God, where are you? Why are you silent? But that is not new to us. God was silent when they were stoning Stephen. Was he not there? He was there. Very quiet. Because he knows the right time is going to judge all of
them.
Now, a believer who doesn't know this, as we try to contend for the faith, and the false ministers continue to grow more worse, that believer can actually be discouraged and think, why don't we just follow the norm of that day? Because even so and so is doing it, how am I going to be separate? But the Bible says to honestly contend for the faith Now what are we talking about? The common faith. You don't defend it. Probably your kids might not enjoy. Might not enjoy what God has intended for them. Enjoy it during their time. So you and I, as we are living, we are the ones to continue to contend, such that those that are going to come behind us, they have an example that may have gone before them. That's very important. Contending for the faith. Why does he say that? Look at the next word. Which was once. How many times was it delivered? It was delivered once. That's the reason as to why we are to contend. What we have is not going to be given again. You hear people actually sharing of things to do with special revelation. Saying God has revealed to me something that I've never even seen in the scripture. I have never heard any person talking about it or sharing it. That's a lie. That's a lie. You didn't just know, but it has always been there. Do you know that Ecclesiastes 1:9 says that there's nothing new that is under the sun? So whatever appears to be new to you, it is because you've just found it out. But let me just actually let me prove that to you. I'm using the scripture here. In Ecclesiastes chapter 1 and the verse is 9. This is what it says. It says, the things that have been, it is that which shall be, and that which is done is that which shall be done, and there is no new thing under the sun. The same is true in chapter 3, verses 15. So when we go on talking about new revelation, it's new to you. Maybe you've never come to that level. But everything God wants us to know has already been put in this simple book. The Bible also says here, that which has been is now, and that which is to be has already been, and God requireth that which is past. Where is the new revelation here? Unless you are just new to the idea. That is why the man says here, the reason as to why we should contend, it was once delivered. And if it is once delivered, any person that tries to dilute it, you have no any opportunity of these apostles writing again. You look at 2 Peter. Now this is very important for us to understand that as Peter makes some of these wordings, he actually also warns us of some of the things we should be very careful about. Now let us look at this one here. 2 Peter and the verses 2. That's what I wanted to read. 2 Peter 3 verses 2. This is what he says. That you may be mindful of the words which were spoken before. Are you listening? That you may be what? Mindful of words which were spoken before. Are they going to be spoken again? What is the meaning of before? What was said before is what we are going to go with. Are you following? By what? By the holy prophets, and of what? The commandment of us, the apostles of the Lord and Savior. That's why Jude says, the reason as to why we should contend what was already given by the prophets and the apostles is what should remain. We should not have any dilution. We should not have any person trying to add or subtract. Now, that's why you need also to take your position. Whatever you know as the truth, don't compromise it with any other thing. Just actually continue to hold fast onto that. Don't change. The same is true in Titus 1:9. Let us look at these things. Let's see what the Bible actually has. Titus 1:9. It says holding fast. Holding fast. Have you ever, I don't know if many of you know the grip of the children. When a child holds those babies, if they hold something, you find as if they are very strong. I don't know if you know kids are, but when they get hold of something, you have to fight with them to get it. They are not very strong, but whenever something gets into their small part, they will hold on to it and say, baby, leave.
Why worry?
The baby is not leaving until you actually distract them with some other thing. And they let go. Now, if babies can hold so fast like that, how about you that have lived for years? So hold fast.
The
Bible adds into say in verses
9,
the faithful word, as he has been taught, the word has already been taught. God is not asking us to add on to it. Neither is he asking us to subtract or to come with special new revelations. This is all sufficient. Holding fast to the faithful word as has been taught, that he may be able by sound doctrine both to exhort and to convince the gainsayers. Who are the gainsayers? Let me tell you, Kenneth. You are estranged. God can still give us a new revelation. Those are the gainsayers. Now, you want to limit God? Now that means that we need to dig into the ministration of the Holy Spirit. The Bible says he's to remind us of all the truth. Meaning that truth is already given. And he will not speak of himself. But whatever he shall receive of me, he will give to you. Now why do I say that? The revelation of God is maximally and exclusively limited to the written word or to the words of Christ. That is why Hebrews 1:1 says God, who at sundry times, mark the tenses, who at sundry times, listen, in diverse manners, do you have the verse there? In diverse what?
Manners.
Spoke in time past to the fathers by the prophets. That time was there. But what are you going to do with verses
2?
But has in these last days spoken unto us by his son. That's the end of it all. It is all put here. And that's the same thing. When Peter, John and James were taken to the holy mountain, they desired to make 3 tabernacles. One for Moses, one for Elijah, and one for Jesus. The Father says, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Listen to him. So we don't listen to any other thing other than what
God.
And that's the reason for 2 Peter chapter 3 and verses 2, which has told us that something was already given by the prophets and the apostles. So any person today saying there is a special revelation that is not in line with what we have here, just say Ikabad. Meaning the spirit has departed. The spirit has done what? Departed. That person is lying to you. Why is that one so? Because still in Jude, verses 17, he adds into say, but beloved, remember, because you know we are fond of forgetting, remember you, the words which were spoken before, the apostles of our Lord Jesus Christ. Why should we contend? Because this has been delivered once. It's just like we all know. Is Jesus going to die again? The Bible says he died once. And the second time he comes, we're not going to pay for someone's sins again. No. He's coming to give salvation to everyone that is waiting for him. And even when he entered into the most holiest place, he didn't enter there many times. He entered there once and he obtained for us the eternal redemption. So everything is once. The death is once. The redemption is once. The scriptures were given once. That's the Bible. So if you are looking out for voices, God speak to me in a special way that none has ever heard. Let me tell you, the devil will speak to you. The devil do what? I don't know if I told you of a lady in America who has actually written a devotion that is paged 360 days. She calls that devotion Jesus Calling. And the idea is, she said that I needed more of the Lord than what the Bible reveals. And right now, in that devotion, she has written her own scriptures. But they say that devotional book has replaced what we call purpose-driven life. Rick Warren. So that basically means it has more sales now. And people are buying it basically because they say they need more than what we have in the Bible. But I'm telling you, that is all false. And she says the Lord is now has spoken to her. So the Lord told her to write them down. So now they have become a devotional book. And some of you will find that book and you buy it and say, my
book,
Jesus Calling. It is the devil calling. It's not Jesus Calling. Because this is it that we have. We are to contend for what was once delivered. If you are looking for any other way, let me also tell you this. God will not speak to us in a way that contradicts his scripture. There is nothing in the scripture that tells us that God will speak to us in a manner that the scriptures do not say. So you just need to be very careful. So the Bible adds in to say, contending earnestly for the faith which was once delivered unto the saints. Question is, who are the saints? You and I are the saints. Now Paul also says it in Philippians 1. Let us also look at what Paul says here. In Philippians 1:27. This is what he says. Only let your conversation be as it becometh the gospel. Our conversation should all be based on the gospel. Not a diluted gospel. Not a watered down gospel. No. The gospel of Christ. That whether I come and see you or else be absent, I may hear of your affairs, even when the Lord is not with us physically in the flesh. He wants our conversation to be gospel based, where we are not trying to add, where we are not trying to subtract, but we reaffirm with what is already given unto us. The Bible says that you might stand, in one spirit, in one mind, striving together. The same word for striving together here, we can use it for the same thing to say with contending for the faith that was once delivered. Striving together for the faith of the gospel. This is not a one man is show. It's not a one man is work. On the individual basis, wherever you go, continue to strive. The people you meet, share with them the true gospel. That's why he says we should stand in one spirit, in one mind, striving together for the faith of the gospel. Did you know that the gospel has the faith? The faith of what? Of the gospel. Can you imagine? Now look at 28. And in nothing, terrified by your adversaries. Because as you try to contend, some people are going to say, that man is a cult. Why is Pastor so-and-so not preaching that? Who does he think he is? Does he own Uganda? Where did he drop from? But the Bible says, in nothing, terrified by your adversaries. What is an adversary? A person that opposes. Altogether, an enemy. The Bible says, which is to them an evident token of the perdition, but to you of salvation, that of God. Are you going to follow the majority because the majority are speaking that language? Let me tell you, even the false ones have their followers. With all the mighty signs God did with Moses, there was a man known as Korah and Dathan. They said, Moses is joking. Even as God uses us, God speaks to us. Is he the only person? They are here together as if the ministry has become their family business. Aaron is here. Miriam is here. Who are they? And then the people listen to them. I think you have a point. I'm joining you. And they gain numbers. And as they gain numbers, the story is in the book of Numbers, chapter 16. And what happened? God told Moses, separate from them. Let me just show to them that I don't speak to them. Just made the ground to swallow all of them. But what is very amazing is that mightily as the Lord had used Moses, people could not actually accept that Moses was the man of God at that time. So they tried to provoke. But the Bible says the ground actually opened, swallowed them and then covered as if nothing had happened. God can deal with you silently. silent. I know what you get even to know about. On several occasions, one time actually Numbers 11, he told him that you God, we don't understand you. You are able to open the Red Sea and you walked on the dry ground. But how about the meat? In Egypt, we are eating the meat.
Egypt, we are eating.
Can't you do that? The Bible says he made them eat meat until it came from their nostrils, so that they can get satisfied very well with meat. Because even when they saw the meat, they said, but this meat cannot be enough for all of us. Wanting to help God, they ate until it came through, and Moses, at least he had to intercede for them and say, God, forgive them. But those things cannot happen right now. Not that God cannot do them. However, he has the right time. According to Acts 17, verses 30 to 31, there is an appointed day of judgment when God is going to judge for the wrong thing. But right now, it's just the time of the dispensation of grace. He's giving them an opportunity to change their minds, to turn away from all of those things. And this is one thing that the Bible tells us in 2 Timothy chapter 2 verses 25 to 26, and I'm also praying that the same way God has enabled us to know some of you, I pray that the Lord will do for many of those ministers who might basically be sincere, but they have not just come to the knowledge of the truth. And maybe those other people are following wrong teachers, not because they want, but they are actually assuming that they are the true ministers. But now you look at the scripture in 2 Timothy chapter 2 and the verses are 25. The Bible says, in meekness, though instructing those that oppose themselves. Who they that oppose themselves? Even when they are doing the wrong thing, they want to actually push for their way. The Bible has it to say, to oppose themselves. If God, peradventure, will give them repentance to the acknowledging of the truth. So whoever is still lost somewhere there, this is the simple prayer I can have for them. God alone knows whether he will grant them repentance so that they can come to this place of acknowledging of the truth. However, the Bible still tells us the ones he will not grant the repentance, he will actually deliver a spirit of delusion over them, or what we call a spirit of error. They will believe the lie to be the truth, because, and that does not just happen like that. All along God has been trying them, but finally he looks at them, they are not willing. Let me tell you, if God says, I am done with you, it means it's done. You get that? At first, do you remember how he dealt with Pharaoh? He first did some simple things, and still Pharaoh was not responding. And God now realized, you know what? This man is not willing. Now I'm going to harden your heart so that you don't change. At the end of it all, it paid Pharaoh expensively. Because if God touches a person's heart and he chooses to harden it, there is no any preaching, there is no any laying of hands that will ever change that person. The person will be lost. And whoever tries to lay hand upon him that the Lord has hardened, you are also opposing the Lord. You're opposing the Lord.
Lord. I believe God has called you. Yet you are very sure that the fruit of this man has nothing to do with God is what? You are playing it secretly and indirectly, opposing the Lord. You might be the next one. So your work is to follow what the word of God says. The Bible says, contending for that which was already delivered. Isn't that the same thing Moses said? Let us look at Deuteronomy chapter 4 and the verses 2. Deuteronomy chapter 4 and the verses 2. The Bible says, you shall not add
baby medu.
But we still leave the people alone. verses 2. You shall not add unto the word which I command you. This is Moses. And these are the last moments of his time with these guys. He says, you shall not add to the word which I command you. Neither shall you diminish aught from it, that you should keep the commandments of the Lord your God, which I command you. Has the Lord changed? Does he want us to add? No. You can call it amplified or what and what. But God is not seeking for us. He tried to expand or add it on it in the way that the word of the Lord will lose its meaning. So he says, you shall not. And then Jude says, we are to honestly contend. These two people never met. But the mindset which Paul talked to us in Philippians 1:27-28 is the same we are seeing, where we are supposed to be in one mind and in one spirit, struggling for the faith of the gospel. The same is true in chapter 12, verses 32, Deuteronomy. This is what he says. Whatsoever thing I command you, observe to do it. You shall not add there unto, nor diminish from it. God does not want any of us to have any addition. And what, one thing I'm telling you today, since the prominence of an individual or a minister has replaced the sound doctrine, people are more liable to believe the statement of a minister even when it contradicts the scriptures, to the point where they have also come to a place of esteeming success above scriptures, saying, what do you have to say? This man is already rich. I think the Lord has revealed to him. The Bible says we should not add. Because you know, people are intimidated by someone's success. But no one should add to what we already have. Let us also look at Proverbs 30 verses 6. Proverbs chapter 30 and the verse is 6. This is what the Bible says. It says, add you not unto his words, lest he reprove you and you be found a liar. The Bible says we are known to add. But if you don't understand that, you can roll back to verses 5. The Bible says every word of God is what? Do you need to add? The Bible says every word of the Lord is pure,
And he is assured unto them that put their trust in him, not those that try to add. That is why verses 5 is supplemented by verses 6 that says you shall not add to his words. Because they are pure, God does not have our mind there. He doesn't want our mind there. We take it the way it is. Then how about Ecclesiastes? To love. And the verse 13. Let us see what this man says. And actually see that there's a balance to all of these things. The Bible says, let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God and keep his commandments. For this is the duty. For this is the whole duty of man. So we are not called to add. About the last book, Revelation 22, and the verse is 18 to 19. What does the Bible say? This is what he says in verses 18. He says something very important. For I testify unto every man that heareth the words of prophecy. Now, isn't this one very true with what we saw? In 2 Peter 3:2. The prophets gave us the commands and the apostles gave us. So the Bible says, I testify unto every man. Now, women do not have to exclude themselves. Because in the scripture, women are seen in men. So don't say they are only talking to men. They are also talking to you. That's why you have the last word on your being woman, man. Woman. So they are talking about all of us. So you might have a womb, but you're a man. Why is that one so? We are spirits. Do you know that? Spirits have no gender. That's why in heaven there is no marrying. You fail to do it here. You go say, but God, why? You marry now if you can. For I testify unto every man, he that heareth the words of the prophecy of this book. For if any man, which man is that one? Even if you are called Gorilla Moses, you have all the muscle. If any man shall do what? Add unto these things, God shall add unto him the plagues that are written in this book. Verses 19. And if any man shall take away, we are not only to add, but we are also not to do what? To take away. Bible says if he shall take away from the words of this prophet book, a prophecy, God shall take away his part out of the book of life, out and out of the holy city, the things which are written in this book. So it is very important that we consider that. So we are not to add anything. Neither are we to subtract. Let us see what Paul says. Timothy. 2 Timothy. Chapter 4. 2 Timothy. Chapter 4. Now look at verses 3 and 4. The Bible says, for the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine. Why should we contend? The time will do what? Are we in that time? We are in that time. They will not endure. Even when the sound doctrine is being preached, there are those who will say no. There is something else. They will not endure sound doctrine. But after their own lust, shall they heap to themselves teachers having itching ears. Do you know the itching ear? How would it be?
Aha, very well. Well, have you seen people say something disturbing me? So you try to put there your small finger. It's not working. Some of you are even weird. You get pains. You become your own doctors. Because something is disturbing. So that's the same thing. When people do not settle for the sound teaching, they are looking for something that aligns with their ears. That's why we should contend. And why should we contend? They will have their own teachers who preach what they like, what they want to hear. Now, verses 4. It says, they shall turn away their ears. This is why we believe that man is a free moral agent. Man can choose to accept, and man can choose not to accept. We are not like people believe in what we call Calvinism. Because with them they say, what will be, even if you don't believe, if God has decided to save you, He will save you. So now for you are just there, everything goes to who? To God. If I'm not saved, that is God's business. If I'm saved, that is still God's business. No, the Bible says here, they shall turn away. Do they have the brain? They have the brain. They know what is right. They know what is wrong. But they adamantly and deliberately choose to turn away their ears from the truth. And the Bible says, they shall be turned unto mere stories. Or what the Bible calls fables. Now verses 5 tells what? Tells us something.
But
watch you in all things. And endure affliction. Since we are contending for something that many do not want to uphold, what you should be sure about is enduring affliction. Last time when I was teaching about the truth about tithing and giving, there is a student who gave me a testimony that when he had gotten our material concerning the tithing, the recorded message, he began sharing it in the church where he was. And many of the people that are actually together with him in the ministry, within Igulu here, actually, something that happened is that there were some nearby churches around there. And now these other pastors heard that this guy is teaching something different. So they went to the landlord of the owner of that place where they were hosting their fellowship. And they asked him, how much are they giving you? We want that place. And these guys, Bambi, they don't have enough. But they are trying to stand for that. Because the gentleman said, whatever he learns in class is what he teaches. And so, they were chased away from where they were fellowshipping from. Because of upholding onto what the sound teaching is. That is part of what we call afflictions and persecution. They might actually send you out of a particular place. Not because the Lord is not with you, but that's the system in the world. However, whatever God has started, God is always able to bring it to the point of finishing it. To the man told us, I am strong. Though now, he told us he's very now what? Very far somewhere. So like that. But persecution will be there. Like that. Because it is, if it happened during that time, it will also happen in our time. We should be ready for that. Now, verses now 4 of Jude. The Bible says, for there are certain men. There are certain men. Jude 1:4.
crept in unawares. How have they come in? They have come in secretly. They appear to be a part of the body of Christ, but they are not a part of the body, because all their teachings are complete blasphemy. They are not upholding to the rightful doctrine. And the Bible says they have crept in unaware. That's why we need to stand sober and watch what really happens. Because if you are not paying attention, you might actually think that those men are not around. The greatest enemies of the body of Christ are within the church. Because if the devil cannot win you, he will join you. So let me just be there. And I also pretend from you. And I'm not lying to you. Study the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 13, when he talks about the parable of the wheat and the tares. Yeah, put the word there, you deal with it. See, the translation is not easy. That's why we thank the Lord. I'm telling you, a person can just put there the word. You battle with it. Maybe go to another. So, but the Bible says that the tares and the wheat had to grow together. And one of the servants, being the angel, said to the Lord, why should they grow together? God said, let them continue. But at the right time, I'll separate. You get that? So in the church, of course we know, I believe not in this place, we have the goats and we have the sheep. In wherever you go, and you know, goats have some resemblance with what? With a sheep. When you only see the front end, you may not tell a major difference. But the Lord knows. All of us are seated here, but the Lord knows the real one. So me, I can say, not here. And I always say, Kenneth, the goats are there. The goats are there. So, but anyhow, we believe that as the gospel is being shared, all of us before we came into place, we had some mannerism of the goats. But the gospel went on sanctifying us. That is why Jesus told his disciples in John 15:3, that you've been made clean by the word has spoken unto you. So the word can cleanse. Are we together? Very important. The same is true in 2 Timothy 2:19. The Bible says, the Lord knows they that belong to him, because he has put his seal upon them. That's one thing that happens. So here he says, certain men, the Bible does not mention their names, they have crept in unaware. Now, how do you get to know that they have crept in unaware? When they do not hold fast to what has already been taught. If you hear any person not sharing what has already been taught in the scripture, you just get to know that that individual has crept in unaware. Could you be that you are not attentive? Take an example in 1 Timothy chapter 1, verses, let us begin with 18 to verses 20. 1 Timothy chapter 1, verses 18. This is what it says. This church I commit unto you. It doesn't to say Saint Timothy, according to the prophecies which went before on you, that you by them you might war a good warfare. What are we called to do? To woe a very what? A good woe, fair. Look at 19. Holding faith and good conscience, which some, having put away concerning faith, have made shipwreck. In other words, they have deserted their faith. It is possible for a person to desert. And now, like example Paul gives us, is in verses 20. Of whom is what? Hymenaeus and Alexander, whom I have delivered unto Satan, that they may learn not to blaspheme. Within the compound of Paul, people actually blaspheme. And he says, that one I just chose to deliver him. Let the Lord deal with him. And let the devil himself work on him. So it is very possible that even as we are here, one of us can just turn around and just begin to oppose the truth. But let me tell you something that the Bible also gives us in 2 Timothy chapter 4. This is Paul, as he was contending for the faith. Something that really happened. The Bible says in verses 16. It says,
what you want?
At my first answer, no man stood with me. Is it not very terrifying? In all places this guy ministered. When he had a trial, stand before different magistrates, Paul says, no man stood with me. That is not ministry. Where you seated before a plate of fried eggs. Sometimes it is very challenging. Imagine this. At my first answer, if I happen to get time to study the entire chapter 4, he explains a lot of adversity that he had to go through. And he says, now let me just show something a little bit here. In verse 14, he says, Alexander, the coppersmith, did much evil. And the Lord reward him according to his works. The man was persecuted, and by the temple began mentioning that name. You see, there are people today who do not subscribe to this. But let me tell you, it's Bible order. If you know a person not sharing the truth, actually the Bible allows you, it gives you an allowance even to mention their names. And say, Susan, the one who teaches the truth, all together. But again, the person is not doing the right thing. Still, there is an allowance. We have seen Alexander. We have seen Hymenaeus. Now here he talks about the Alexander, the coppersmith again. And he says, he did much evil to me. And may the Lord reward him. The apostle of grace. He said, may the Lord do what? Reward him. It was not easy. Verses 15. Of whom be aware, as we are contending for the faith, there are some people you need to be aware of. You've heard about them, and they do not teach the truth. Please avoid them. Why are we to avoid them? Because the Bible says they have been rebuked time and time again, but they don't change. Is it true? Yes, Titus chapter 3, verses 10 says, a man that is an heretic, after the first and second admonition, rejects. Isn't that the same thing that we see in Romans chapter 16, the verse 17? Let us go there. This has to be nailed properly. The Bible says here in verse 17, now I beseech you, mark them. You see, the Bible wants us to mark the people. Any person not contending for the truth, mark them. Thereof, it adds into say, mark them. Now, the Greek has it as scopeo, meaning that you put a microscope on them. Just put a microscope on them. Understand your message. It's not clear. Mark them that cause division and offense contrary to the doctrine which you have learned. Embrace them.
No.
Do what? Avoid them.
Some
people are going to say, man, that's not the love of Christ. This is the love of Christ. Avoiding what? Avoiding them seriously. Why is that one so? Because verses 18 says, For they are such that serve not our Lord. That's why we are to avoid them. They don't serve our Lord.
That's,
but their own belly. Their own what? And by doing, by good words and fair speeches, deceive the hearts of the simple. You think a person who teaches wrong thing is going to come around and say, look here, I am the one that you should be aware of. I am the one. We are going even to speak nicely, even do some good works, charitable work. You say, but with all of those good things he does, can he be a bad man? The Bible says fair speech. So do not just be taken by a man's word. So because actually he speaks very well, I think he's the right person. No. The Bible says when you mark them, the best you do is to avoid them completely. Say, have nothing to do with you. I used to think you a brother, but what I have understood, you a vampire. You want to finish my life. Running away. Now let me tell you, if Lot could leave his, if he left his wife behind, imagine your wife. The instruction says, don't look behind. And someone, because it's your wife, he says, let us look behind. And you say, sweetheart, let us look behind. You're going to perish with your sweetheart. If the scripture says, don't look behind, please go. But the woman was tempted in the middle of the way. And this is something that I'll show next time. That these are all examples in the Bible. If you turn away from what is in the scripture, it's the same thing as renouncing what was already delivered at
us.
That's why you need to uphold. You think I'm joking? Look at Colossians. Before I finish with the 2 Timothy, this is what it says in Colossians chapter 1, the verses 20-22-23. This is what it says in Colossians 1:22. It says, and in his body of his flesh through death to present you what? Holy and unblameable and unreprovable in his sight. This is what Jesus is going to do. But don't forget verses 23, which some people don't take seriously as we are contending for the faith. 23 says, if you do what? You continue in the faith. Is much able to preserve as long as you do what? You continue in the faith, grounded and settled, and be not moved away from the hope of the gospel which you have heard and which was preached to every creature which is under heaven. And wherefore I, Paul, I am made a minister. You need to uphold to the sound teaching. God is able to preserve, is able to keep us. among us. You say, I have nowhere to go. You are all I have. Now let us finish with this one here. In 2 Timothy. Now verses 15. The Bible says, of whom be aware also, for he has greatly withstood our words.
We
already have those people that have also said wrong things about the school. Already we have them. But the Bible says we should be aware that those people are going to be there. Verse 16. At my first answer, no man stood with me, but all men forsook me. And I pray God that it might not be laid on their charge. Verse 17. Notwithstanding, the Lord stood with me.
What?
This is the most important thing here. That even when they all go, when we are contending for the truth, we have to be very assured that the Lord is with us. Altogether, the pressure will increase. You remember how people celebrated about Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? When they discovered that they are disobeyed, the instruction of the king, they were happy to see people burning. Let me tell you, don't think that those other people were saying, how is they change their minds? In their minds they were saying, you reject, so that we can have a moment of exciting ourselves. And it happened the way they wanted. They said, you throw now them. The very people carry them and throw them. But what is very amazing, to know how that thing was burning hot, is that even the ones that were throwing it, they also got burnt. That's how burning hot the thing was. Anyone coming close, the fire would claim for you. And what is very interesting, there is the Lord that stood with Paul, that stood with them. But even in the fires, he was together with them. And this is the same thing Paul says, when no man stood with me, the Lord stood with me. And then he adds in to say, and strengthen me, that by me the preaching might be fully known. See, God is always looking for a willing and a available vessel. If others turn back, he goes with the ones who are violent. That is why he says that by me the preaching might be fully known, and that other Gentiles might hear. And I was delivered out of the mouth of the lion. Now, do you know the lion during that time was Nero? An individual being called a lion man is not something simple. That time was not easy. Nero would stand and say, I am God, and whoever would not submit to that, he would excite himself by throwing you into hungry lions so that they tear you apart. And they laugh and shout and say, look at that foolish pastor. That is why you hear during the time of Paul, there were a lot of games that were carried out. That's where the idea of the Olympics came from, where people were participating in different games. But men of these games were ungodly. You feeding people with lions, is it godly? Burning a person alive like Polycarp, they burnt him alive. But what is very amazing, church history tells us that no fire actually touched his body. They realized that the fire could not burn him, it had to just kill him straight.
The same they did with James.
James.
I mean another James in the Bible.
James, look at the Bible.
They threw him from a high pinnacle where the devil had taken Jesus, they throw yourself down. But even as they threw him, the man did not die. And again, someone had to come with a big club and hit the head. That is just to show that if God wanted to preserve an individual, even amidst any persecution, he can still do that. He says, I was delivered out of the mouth of the lion. Verses 18. And the Lord shall deliver me from all evil work and will preserve me unto his heavenly kingdom. To whom be the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
I cannot go beyond this point. Let us appreciate the Lord. Father, in the name of Jesus.